Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for your patience and for waiting. I hope you all enjoyed your hot cocoa, courtesy of Eric Evans, and your delicious treats, courtesy of the Friends. And I'd just like to take a moment to thank the 16 and 16 committee who have worked tirelessly coming up with ideas and different ways to get people motivated to read. And this is the 16 and 16 grand finale event this evening. Our special guest, Elin Hilderbrand, she lives in Nantucket, and she is here to read from her 18th book, Winter Storm. So please welcome Elin Hilderbrand.
Hi, thank you. For, I know, I'm sorry because I realized that this is the place where I had to reschedule. Because I was supposed to come in November. I almost feel like it's better that I came now because it's closer to Christmas, a little bit more distance between now and between then and November 8th, so that's good. And I have, I'm reading from Winter Storms, which is the third book in my Winter Trilogy, so I'll just ask, how many of you have read books one and two? Okay, some of you have. I was just at Barnes & Noble in Burlington, and I did not let, they were out of Winter Street, so we're stuck. I don't see him. Oh, there he is. Hey. So they were out of Winter Street, and I would not let anybody buy the other two. Which was like a very interesting exercise in reverse psychology, because instead of me being the author, like, oh, you should just buy the other two anyway, I was like, I'm not going to let you buy the other two. I'm sorry. And they're like, no, please, we'll get it somewhere else. Just please let me buy the other two. So, okay, so I did end up selling a lot of books two and three. But you really should read book one. Do we have Winter Street, Dick? We've got tons, right? And then book two and then book three. So I'm going to read from book three, which will be a little bit of a spoiler for those of you. So, like, plug your ears if that's going to make you upset. But anyway, to talk just a little bit about the Winter series. What happened was, in the summer of 2013, I was writing a novel called The Matchmaker. And my publisher called and said, we've had a book fall off our Christmas list, and would you be able to write a Christmas book in 4 weeks? And I said, no, I can't. And it wasn't even that I couldn't. It was that I was, for those of you who've read The Matchmaker, it's a very, very intense, very sad book. And I didn't want to interrupt myself and get distracted. I said, but I will write a Christmas book for you next year. And then as I was thinking about it, I thought, really, I have a Christmas trilogy in my head. But my publisher, because I had only written summer books up to that point, didn't really trust me to write a trilogy at Christmas. And so they only gave me a one book deal, which was for Winter Street. So I wrote Winter Street and I handed it in, and I intentionally gave it no ending so that they then had to offer me another two book deal, which they did. So I tricked them, and then, sure enough, no sooner had I finished Winter Storms than my publisher called, it was in June or whatever, the summer, and said, what do we have to do to get you to write a fourth book? Like, we love these characters so much, what do we have to do? So I'm like, well, you have to pay me lots and lots of money. And they did, and so Winter Solstice is going to come out next fall. And it will be the fourth book in the trilogy. I'll be the first person ever to do that. And in addition to it being a sequel to the Winter series, it's also going to be a sequel to The Rumor. So for those of you who read The Rumor, the characters from that book are going to come back and be in my novel Winter Solstice. So a bunch of new ground being broken, right? Because it's the fourth four-book trilogy, and it's going to be a double sequel to those two books. So that's all exciting. The Winter Street series is about a family called the Quinns. And the patriarch of the family is Kelly Quinn. And Kelly has been married twice. His first wife's name is Margaret Quinn. She is the anchor for the CBS Evening News in New York. They have three grown children. Patrick, who's a financial criminal. Kevin, who helps run the Winter Street Inn, which is the business on Nantucket that they run, a bed and breakfast, and Ava, who is a music teacher at the elementary school in Nantucket. Kelly's second wife's name is Mitzi, and everyone's laughing. Someone's laughing. Mitzi is Mitzi is ditzy. And they have a son named Bart, who at the beginning of the Winter Street trilogy has been deployed to Afghanistan and goes missing. And in the first page of the first book, Kelly discovers that Mitzi is having an affair with the Santa Claus at the end, George. So that sets the whole chain of events off, and it has its ups and downs. I'm going to read from the third book, Winter Storms, and I'm at the end of my tour. This book came out on the 4th of October. I've done probably, I don't know, 17 or 18 events. I am so sick of the passage that I've been reading that, and I, you know, another person would have prepared something else, but I'm so sick of it that I'm like thinking, what else could I possibly read for these people? So just give me 1 second, because I'm going to figure this out. I can't read too far in, because I think I'm going to read Jennifer. Okay. I'm going to read 2 sections, and they're both really short. So I'm going to read Jennifer, and I'm going to read Kevin. Jennifer is the financial criminal's wife. She's an interior decorator. She's addicted to pills. You're just going to love this trilogy if you haven't read it yet. Jennifer. She drives to exit 5 on Route 3 South, pulls into the parking lot of the Mayflower Deli, and waits. At 12:15, the black pickup drives up and parks beside her. Jennifer removes the envelope of cash from her purse and gets out of the car, scanning the lot for police or anyone who might be undercover. She casually walks to the driver's side. She hands Nora the envelope, and Nora hands Jennifer a bare aspirin bottle that contains 50 oxycodone pills. Nora says, "When does Patty get out?" "June 1st, Jennifer says. Nora's expression is sympathetic, and Jennifer softens toward her former sister-in-law. Gone are the days when Jennifer could claim some kind of moral superiority. Now, sadly, Nora is one of the most important people in Jennifer's life, her dealer. Jennifer had meant to quit the oxy after the holidays, but then she was faced with the quiet, cold weeks of January, and February brought Valentine's Day, and her husband was still incarcerated. Then came March with its surprisingly beautiful weather. Everyone in Boston had spring fever. The sidewalk cafes were packed, lovers held hands and lay on blankets on the Boston Common. Jennifer could see them from the window of her townhouse on Beacon Street. The sight depressed her. Then in April, Jennifer took the boys away for spring break to San Francisco to visit her mother. There was no way she could handle a week with her mother without pharmaceutical help. So now she finds herself in May, still buying drugs from Nora. Meanwhile, she's trying to parent 3 boys and run her interior design business. Today, she has 2 large blue and white porcelain vases valued at over $25,000 apiece in the back of her Volvo to deliver to a client in Duxbury. "So will you be wanting any more, do you think?" Nora asks. Their implicit understanding has been that this new relationship of theirs will end once Patrick gets out of jail. Nora seems to be asking for confirmation of that. Does Nora possibly sense that Jennifer has become an addict? Well, yes, there is a dependency, obviously, but is it permanent? Jennifer has blithely chosen to believe that once Patrick is back in the house, once he is back working, making money, helping out with the boys, and sleeping next to Jennifer in bed, there will be no need for the pills. Patrick's return will be her drug. More likely, Nora is concerned only for her own welfare. Her lifestyle has certainly improved with this new line of work. Jennifer can hardly be her sole client. Nora is probably supplying pills to half the households between Mashpee and Mansfield. Her appearance has changed. She started wearing Eileen Fisher in an eerie, or perhaps flattering, echo of Jennifer herself. Nora Vale, once all denim and leather, is now silk and linen. And she's got on earrings that Jennifer recognizes as Jessica Hicks. Wow, at this rate, Jennifer might soon become Nora's decorator. The thought isn't all that outlandish. Okay, Jennifer thinks, time to leave. I have to scoot, she says. I have two Chinese vases waiting to meet their new parents. So this is it then, Dora says. She eyes the front of the deli. You don't want to go in and grab a sandwich real quick, do you? Jennifer is touched, but also alarmed, mostly at her own feelings of fear and regret. She has grown to sort of like Nora now that their connection has nothing to do with the Quinn family, and she will miss their weekly meetings in a way. I'll call you next time I'm on the island, Jennifer says. Nora's face falls. Both she and Jennifer know Jennifer will never call. Even if she wanted to, she couldn't. Okay, then, Nora says. See you around. Kelly. Do you hear music?
No.
Do you hear it? Okay. I'm on my computer, but I can't actually confirm that. Kelly. The week after his final radiation treatment, Kelly returns to Mass General for an MRI to determine if his cancer is gone. After a tense 5-day wait, Dr. Cherith, a med school classmate of Margaret's fiancé, Dr. Drake Carroll, as it turns out, calls to say Kelly appears to be in the clear. Cancer gone, Dr. Cherith says. No guarantees, of course, but for now, it's safe to say you beat it. After he hangs up, Kelly takes a deep yoga breath, then exhales in an om, the way Mitzi has taught him. Gratitude to Mother Earth, gratitude to God above. He has beaten it. It wasn't easy. Prostate cancer isn't glamorous. Kelly spent over a month in adult diapers, a fact he'd like to forget as soon as possible. And the radiation exhausted him. Thank God Mitzi had left George and come back to him. She took complete control of his treatment and made every decision. She brought Kelly breakfast in bed each morning, organic bowls with fruit and seeds and nuts, and every night she read to him. They got through the first three Harry Potters, books Kelly had longed to read. He loved magical fantasy stories, but back when they were published, his kids were far too old for them and his grandchildren not old enough. Mitzi has a wonderful reading voice, clear and expressive, and at one point, Kelly had rolled to her and said, "Have you ever considered a career in broadcasting?" She glowered at him. "I'm Mitzi, Kelly, not Margaret." "I know that," Kelly had said, although he then realized he'd gotten mixed up for a second. That was another side effect of the radiation, mental confusion. Kelly had such intense dreams that he sometimes mistook them for reality. In the most vivid, the U.S. military made contact with members of the Afghan rebel group Belai, the faction that was holding Bart and his comrades prisoner, and asked what they would accept in exchange for the soldiers. The Belai had responded that they wanted Leonardo DiCaprio and 100 dozen Mrs. Fields chocolate chip cookies. The transaction had gone through, and Bart had come home, whole and unharmed, unmarred except for a tattoo of a star on his cheek. Mitzi had screamed, her baby's face, but Kelly had simply gathered his son into his arms, kissed the star, and thought, "I am never letting this kid go." When Kelly woke up, he'd experienced that particular elation one feels when something valuable that has been lost is returned. But then, upon realizing it was just a dream, Kelly fell back into his shallow pool of despair. William Burke from Bart's platoon is still unconscious. Back in February, he had been transported from Landstuhl in Germany to Walter Reed in Bethesda, and the whole world is waiting for his condition to improve. Kelly had toyed with the idea of going to Bethesda himself to visit William Burke. Kelly had just enough hubris to believe that his presence might be the very thing to snatch Private Burke from the jaws of darkness. But Mitzi told Kelly the idea was impractical. He had to fight his own battle. He has fought the battle and emerged victorious. He will tell everyone the news soon enough. But first, Kelly is going to walk down Main Street to the Nantucket Pharmacy lunch counter, where he will order the ham and pickle sandwich on rye bread and a chocolate frap. He has been dreaming of this exact lunch for months, but it has remained a fantasy. While he was sick, Mitzi put him on an organic vegetarian diet. If Kelly never sees a leaf of kale again, it will be too soon. Thank you. Okay, so we have time. I'll take a couple questions. If you have questions about anything, you can ask me about this, the other books, or anything, my writing. Yes, in the back.
I do have one question. As an author, what are your thoughts and feelings about ebooks, and do you read ebooks?
I do not read ebooks. The industry has changed so drastically from when I started. So I started in the year 2000, and one of the stories I tell is how my first book came out, The Beach Club, and 2 weeks after it was out, People Magazine made a Beach Book of the Week. Now, this is a book for which I received a $5,000 advance, and they printed 2,500 copies. And when it came out in People Magazine, you couldn't download it because that concept didn't even exist. So basically what happened was every single of the 2,500 copies sold, and there was a long period of time when there were no books, which was very frustrating as a first-time author, because here I got this awesome publicity and we can't capitalize on it because the books don't even exist. And if that happened now, basically people would just buy it on their e-reader. It happened to me twice in my career because it happened again in 2006. With The Love Season came out. It was in People Magazine and they ran out of books. And so one of the good things about having ebooks is that it's immediately accessible. If you think about someone like me who's a beach read, if you're on the beach in Nantucket and you finish, you know, The Rumor, you can download all of them while you're sitting there. You don't have to go anywhere. So from that point of view, I think it's a wonderful thing. I am kind of a purist. Do I not read ebooks? Like, I buy hardcovers and I'm keeping a library for my kids, which is probably going to be like so outdated by the time they're old enough to inherit it. But it's, you know, real books and books that I've read, and I've marked the pages and everything, and I believe in real books. But if you look at my sales figures from even since The Island, I can remember The Island came out in 2010, and I sold a quarter in ebook and three quarters in hardcover, and those numbers have 100% flipped. So I will sell three quarters in ebook and a quarter in hardcover now. Yes.
I was wondering, do you usually start with characters in mind or a plot in mind? How do you start?
So the question is, how do I start? When I start a novel, the nice thing about the trilogy, which is why it's easier for me to do them, is because the characters already exist. So it's not reinventing the wheel. With the summer, yeah, I'll take that tip next. With the summer books, it's reinventing the wheel every single time. And what I'm finding that right now, at the very, very end of revising The Identicals, which is coming out in June, and I'm writing scenes now, but the thing is I've now spent 7 months with these people, so I know them. But when you're first starting out, I write four or five notes about the pages of notes about the characters, and then I just dive in and sort of proceed along and see where they take me. But then in the revising process, which happens November, December, you're really going back and you know them, and it's easier to figure out the plot. Like, what happens? What would they do? So I turn the book in at the end of October. My editor at Little Brown will write me a long letter saying, this is what you have to fix, and this is what works, what doesn't work. This book isn't so bad, but the last three, so The Matchmaker, The Rumor, and Here's to Us, all had to be rewritten numerous times to get it right. But the most important thing is the characters, because you have to love them. You have to absolutely love them. Otherwise, why turn the pages? Do I know any of the people in my book? Are you asking me if they're based on real people? It's always the first question. It's usually always the first question. So I live on an island that's 4 miles wide and 13 miles long and has 10,000 year-round residents. I don't write about real people. Now, part of it is because I have children in school and I like my friends, but part of it is that real characters don't, whether or not we realize it, fiction is crafted to make sense. So fiction, every single thing that you put in the book has to contribute to the storyline, otherwise it doesn't belong there, it's boring or whatever. We as human beings have all kinds of aspects and things that don't make sense. And even as nice as this event is, if I wrote a novel about it, we would all fall asleep. I mean, it's because real life is boring, right? So real life is boring. Lots of the details of our life don't make narrative sense the way we like to read about it. And so everything has to be crafted in a narrative. So real people don't fit. Now, when I wrote my novel, The Rumor, it's about gossip on Nantucket and people blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, okay, everybody that gossips on Nantucket is going in this book. And I'm going to get back at everybody in that way. So I set out, and I'm going to write The Rumor, and I'm writing it. And I have to, by necessity, because of the storyline, I have to change everybody that I started out with so that nobody knows who they are except for me, which ended up working out really well. Because they're in there. They just don't know it. Yes.
Have you ever found yourself to be in a position that Madeline found herself in when she didn't have anything to write about? That she was desperate enough to
right. No, I thought that was really funny though. So in The Rumor, I have a novelist and she's totally stuck for an idea, so she starts writing about her best friend's affair as it's unfolding, which is really actually a brilliant concept. No, I don't. But it's so funny because even when I'm reading this book, like, things will happen. So I must have written the first part of this book when I was on vacation last year in Trinidad and Tobago, because there was a guy staying at my hotel named Dr. Cherith, and he was an Indian gentleman. And I'm like, I'm going to use your name and put it in my book. And sure enough, I'm reading it. I'm like, oh, you know, it's just his name. And he was a doctor, but it means, you know what I mean? So I do use bits and pieces of things that are happening to me, but not in any meaningful way that they would recognize it, really. You know, so, and I don't write about the real things that are happening to my friends. Again, not because I don't want them to hate me, just because they aren't interesting enough. Yes.
Do you have a favorite one of your books and a favorite character?
My favorite book is The Blue Bistro. Has anybody read The Blue Bistro? Yay! Are you clapping because it's your favorite too? Yeah. So, I don't know, we haven't took yet. The Blue Bistro is my favorite. It's about a restaurant on Nantucket and has a great love triangle in it. And for whatever reason, it didn't sell very well when it came out in hardback. In fact, it sold terribly. And it was the thing that sort of lit a fire under my butt to do more things to promote myself, which eventually ended up just fine. But and then later, 6 years later, after it was published, after I was a big star with Silver Girl, it did hit the New York Times bestseller list for 1 week. In paperback and like number 30, but I'm like, you know what? It had its moment. It's my favorite book. And another one of my favorite books is Summerland, and the character of Hobby, I think, is probably my all-time favorite character. He's a young man, and his twin sister dies in a car accident, and he's paralyzed. And he's in a coma, rather. It's one of my favorite books. Anybody else? Oh, lots of people now. Yes, in the back.
What's your best-selling book?
I think that would be Here's to Us. They. I'm very, very lucky and very grateful. They all sell better than the next. Yeah. So, because I keep getting, it's a machine. It's a business plan. So every book that comes out sells better than the next, because then you get fans along the way. So it's like a big snow sweeper. You know what I mean? And you have a book come out, and then all the others. The backlist will sell, but each book you get more fans, and the more fans you have, then when your new book comes out, that always sells better. So the one that sold the most copies, I think in hardback, is the last one. Probably the one that sold the most copies overall is Barefoot. Barefoot was on the New York Times bestseller list for 26 weeks. So I think overall it's sold somewhere in seven figures. Yeah. Yes.
So do any of your characters, I noticed that you used Fast Eddie from The Rumor into, the second book.
Right.
Do any of the other characters appear in any of your other books?
Well, the police chief appears in a bunch. Oh, he starts in The Castaways, and then he shows up again a couple of times. I'm going to write a book where he's the main character at some point. And who else? There's like a couple characters. Who show up, but it's not like the Boltons. I mean, it's not like a, you know, the same characters don't keep coming back, but every once in a while you'll see different characters, which is fun, I think. Yes.
Would any of your books become movies?
Would any of my books become movies? So I think movies are over. Don't you guys? What do we really want? We really want an Amazon or Netflix series called Nantucket Nights, and then every season is like you combine two books, and then it's like these two books are the season, and these two books are the season. That's what we want, right? Movies are over. Forget that. Plus, it would be like this. I think the Christmas series would be good for like an ensemble Christmas movie. I don't have any control over this. So right now, they're all up for grabs if you guys want to make the movies. Or do the series, but I do think, yeah, I think the way the world is moving, for my own personal entertainment, I did go to the movies last week, but I rarely go. It's just too much work when you can just sit with your computer and just binge. Yeah. It's so much easier. So, yeah, something a little bit more binge-worthy, if I didn't think it would totally ruin Nantucket. Yes.
Who do you read?
Right now, I just finished a book called The Commonwealth by Ann Patchett. Has anybody read that? That was wonderful. And I wrote a book called Nutshell by Ian McEwan, who's another really brilliant writer. So I read contemporary fiction. A lot of times what's on the New York Times bestseller list. I like good stuff. I feel like the best stuff that I read, it makes my writing better. Because reading really, really good writing, it instead of, you know, people are like, aren't you afraid you're going to plagiarize it? No, I'm not afraid I'm going to plagiarize it because I have my own voice. But it makes me up my game a little bit. So I like reading really good literature. Okay, one more. Yes?
Where is your favorite place to write?
Where is my favorite place to write? Well, I write all of my novels longhand. So, in fact, I have the revisions, the longhand. The reason I was just a little bit late is I was in the car and I was in the middle of a scene and I'm like, I can't get out of the car until I finish. The driver's like, it's 7:03. I can't get out until I finish. But the beach, you know, so I can take you to the beach and the pool. And I do that. I do that all the time in the summer. And then in the spring I go to St. John and right on the beach there. And it's wonderful. Okay, this is how we're going to do this. I'm going to sign here, right, Dick? Yeah. So you're going to come up and get your books and then come over here. And I will do pictures, but because I am in the middle of a work schedule, if you came with a friend, we're going to do HOV lane for pictures. So grab your friend and let's get all of the picture together because there's a lot of you in it, you know. We don't want this to take forever, right? And I haven't had dinner yet. So, and I'll sit, and then you can just stand behind me, and then we'll find somebody to take the pictures, okay? Thank you so much.